No people at the lost and found.
There is absolute silence.
Absolute silence. That means people are happy.
Yeah.
You wanna kick it off? I'm not as
I
back.
can kick it off,
Cool.
yeah. Yeah,
Yeah,
I can kick it off.
let's see.
Yeah.
Let's go.
All right. All right. Hi, everyone. Thank you so much for waiting while Hans and I just talked for 4 minutes. So, my name's Esther Horowitz, and I'm a senior content designer. I work on Power Virtual Agents. I'm part of Microsoft's business applications and platform team. And as you can probably tell from the fact that you clicked on the link and from the title on the screen, we are here to talk about building conversational bots that engage your users. And my team has developed some best practices for conversational design. And sorry as I cough throughout this. I'm sure we're all aware of what's going on. These best practices are an amalgamation of the things that we've learned throughout our years of experience in the industry on different platforms and through our work on Power Virtual Agents. And of course, collaborating and talking with Hans. Power Virtual Agents itself is built to allow anyone, whatever their background, so if it's something traditional like coding, linguistics, or human computer interaction, or something sort of completely off the beaten path, whoever you are, Power Virtual Agents allows you to create conversational systems. And the process of actually creating a bot isn't really smooth. If you've ever been on any project, end to end, you know this. You think improvements are sort of building up over time to create smooth sailing, sort of all the way to the finish line. But that's never really the case, is it? Creating a bot is just like any other project. Things are going well. You're building on what you've learned. You're moving forward. And then you hit a snag, and it kind of all seems to fall apart. But when you keep going and work through those problems, your finished project, excuse me, your finished project is even better than what you expected when you started out. And I'm not saying this to dissuade you from designing a bot. There are a couple of reasons to bring this up. One is, let's normalize this. Everybody goes through this process when building a bot. And two is so that you don't get discouraged when you're building a bot. You know that you can and should push on through to that finish line. Now, creating a bot can be broken down into roughly four phases: understanding, designing, materializing, and testing. And these phases can be seen when you zoom out and look at the bot as a whole, excuse me, and when you look at the individual features that you are creating within that bot. And so, what do we mean by each of these phases? The understanding phase is when you're looking to figure out users and scenarios. You're figuring out the user journey. What needs does the user have? What's the user doing? And how does this all align with your organization's goals? During the design phase is when you'll want to consider how can you meet those user needs that you've already identified. The materialize phase is when your team takes the design plans that you've laid out in the previous phase and implements them. And the testing phase is when you figure out how your experience aligns with real-world use, and you get that feedback that lets you know how you've hit the mark. And all of these phases are interconnected. Your implementation work may uncover new technical constraints that kick you back all the way to the drawing board. Or you may find during usability testing that your feature is misaligned with your user's needs. Or you may need to go back and uncover more user needs during the design phase itself. So the process looks linear on the surface, but you really can't separate out one of them. And all of this is to say that design is necessary, but not sufficient for a complete, well-rounded feature or product. Now, I've run into the question of what to call users a few times before. And in fact, Hans and I had a discussion about this yesterday or the day before. So I want to clarify that the way I use user throughout this presentation and in general is a person who uses a product or service. And I know that there are multiple lexical entries in English for user. And one of them, perhaps a more prominent one for some people, is that of a drug user or a person who uses drugs. And I can definitely see how, if that is the predominant definition for you, user might not be the best word for the people that you're designing for. So you can and should pick a different word that works better for you and your community if you are continuously running into this problem as you create your experience. As you come up with a new word that describes your design audience, though, you should keep some things in mind. Keep the human being at the front. You're creating a human-centric experience, so make sure that you begin as you mean to go on. And don't forget that this is usually going to be a word that you use with your design team, your engineers, your PMs, your stakeholders, but not necessarily with the people who are actually using the product or service itself. And of course, this is not a hard and fast rule, but you don't have to use the same terminology internally that you do in your user-facing copy. And of course, consider how inclusive you're being. What is the most inclusive word for the group of people that you're designing for? If you're working on, say, a healthcare experience, and you want to use member instead of user, that's fine. But are you then excluding the sales or signup experience for new members, those people who aren't yet a member, but might become one? What about previous members who might not be a member anymore, but may still need access to their medical records or bill pay options, or may still need to use your product in some other way? Or if you're building an internal experience for employees, will all employees be using this experience? Can you just use employee? And will they be using it regularly? Or will they just be using it to, say, check how much vacation time they have? And so really, your set of employees is actually a set of employees who are actively searching for information about their paid time off balance. Or maybe this is something like an ethics reporting page where employees can use this experience if they need to, but really, hopefully, won't be using it in their daily work life. So if all employees have the option of using this experience when they need or want to, is the design really aimed at employees who are using this experience, right, rather than all employees? So what I'm really trying to drive home here is that the specificity of your words do matter. So you will hear me use the term user throughout, but I really want to make sure to highlight the intentionality of this choice. And when we're intentional about the design choices we make, we can make the entire process of creating a bot, of building an interactive system move more smoothly. Whether that's from a higher level product perspective or a more granular feature level view, intentional design is all about making sure that we zero in on what's important. And that high level understanding of what users are going to do with a conversation system is the starting point. It's where you, as the designer, begin to understand your user's journey and their needs and what your system can do to meet those needs. But you also need to delve into the logistics behind the user's needs and wants. What does it actually mean for your system to be able to answer this particular question or complete this particular task? What decisions are being made sort of behind the scenes? What other platforms might you need to be able to integrate with? What might you need access to? What do users think is going on? What assumptions are they making when they trigger this? Is your design going to align with their mental model of what's going on? And you also need to sort of zoom out and consider, how can I design this so that it's easy for the user? Because if it's easy, if it's useful, if it's fun, people will use it. And with those good design practices, you'll find better audience engagement. Ensuring that you've created a bot that meets a need rather than something generic like an FAQ bot will drive that long-term engagement. Best practice principles come into play when we combine effective design standards with user-focused intentionality. At Microsoft, we've rolled our best practices up to 5 pretty simple but comprehensive best practices for intentional design. Understand your user, focus on the user, keep it simple, keep it clear, use the right tools, and be inclusive. So let's dive a little deeper into these. The first principle is to understand your user. What this means is that you need to make sure you understand what the user is doing. So make those user journeys and validate them. Understand what type of bot personality will help the user find value with the bot interaction and will help build trust with the user. Because if they don't trust your bot, they won't use it. And dream big, like Hans and I were saying right at the beginning of this, dream big. But remember that even those castles in the sky need to be built up one cloud at a time. And once you've launched, understand what you're doing right and maybe what you're doing not so right, so that you know where you can focus on your efforts for improvement. And once you've identified the way or ways in which a bot can help the user, you know what the bot needs to do. If you're building a bot for an organization, you can't just build this bot, though. Let's acknowledge that we don't live in vacuums and that there are other factors that we do need to consider. One of those factors is going to be, does this bot work within my organization's goals? For example, does your organization want to improve metrics in some way? And by the way, the answer to this question is always yes. Or maybe you want to ask, can a bot support my organization's brand strategy somehow? And these may be questions that have some upfront costs to uncover, like time spent going back and forth with your marketing departments, But it really is a front-loaded ask. And this discovery work will help you understand how you can help your user. Because you can build bots that meet a user need while also meeting an organizational need. A common way that you can see this is making sure that easy, high volume requests are handled by a bot instead of a human, which frees up time for human customer service agents to focus on helping users. And it gets information out to those end users more quickly. So things like, where is my order? Or what are your store hours? Or I need to update my address. Things that a lot of users need to do or know, things that they can easily complete themselves if they're given the framework to do it in, things that don't require human oversight. These things tend to be great candidates for low-hanging fruit to include in your bot that will be helpful to your organization while also meeting a user need. Brand guidelines on tone and word choice will really come into play when you're figuring out your bot's personality. You're wanting to make sure to create a bot that provides what the user needs in a way that the user will accept. And some of that is going to come down to persona and tone. If you don't have brand guidelines that you can follow, then you'll need to make sure to have some kind of schema that you can adhere to that will ensure internal consistency. Making sure that the capabilities that you're building into the bot align with the user's needs is, again, the cornerstone of intentional design. And everything about your bot can give the user clues as to what the bot can or can't do, including its name. A human-sounding name has just as many subliminal implications for your bot and its capabilities as a name like, say, HR bot does. The practice of understanding the user also encompasses understanding what the user wants, not just from a needs perspective, but also from a experience perspective. Do they want to know when a bot joins the conversation that they're in? Does the user need a timestamp? Does the user need a picture of a baby koala to make them smile because it's a Monday afternoon? So during the design process, ask yourself, how can your brand strategy support those user needs and those user wants within a bot? The second principle we have is focus on the user. And this might seem like it's a repeat of the previous one, so I'll go over how it's different. Focus on the user is about the intentionality of what you can do within the design itself to make the user feel like they are truly a part of the conversation. Writing in the second person helps the user focus on themselves instead of on abstracts. This isn't just a question of pivoting prompts from how can I help to what are you looking for? It's also things like it's 85 degrees in Miami when the user asks for the weather instead of just saying it's 85 degrees. And for anyone who doesn't use Fahrenheit, 85 Fahrenheit is about 29 Celsius. Don't worry, global warming hasn't gotten that far yet. Miami is not quite that hot. We also want to guide the user through or towards a desired behavior using unambiguous prompts. Clarity is really crucial. So don't let the user flounder wondering what they should be doing. and be a minimalist. What is the least amount of information that the user requires to move on and still be informed? Give them that. You should also give the user confirmation. Don't go overboard and fill up a conversation by repeating everything the user says back to them. But for anything transactional or anything actionable, make sure that the user understands whether or not something has been completed successfully. So for example, if your user has asked to be connected to a live human, make sure they know whether or not a human is being connected into the chat. If you've got a form fill within a bot, do not repeat back all of the information in it. But maybe you can tell the user whether or not that information was sent off successfully. Be reasonable, don't go overboard, because remember, minimalism. But your user shouldn't be confused about whether something was successful or not. And lastly, consider what you would want if you were the user. Do you have all the necessary information? Do you have too much information? And this does not replace usability testing, of course, since oftentimes we as makers are subject matter experts, and therefore we tend to either over or underestimate other people's knowledge in a particular field. But it is a really good exercise to step back and consider your bot from another point of view. Spotlighting the user in your design like this will help the user maintain a positive relationship with the bot. And why is it so important to make sure that we are maintaining a positive connection between bots and users? It's because people connect with their devices. And when their devices can respond with words, that connection is even more powerful. Even though they know that they're not talking to another human, the stimulus of that interaction, the stimulus of that conversation, still triggers very real and very authentic emotional responses. This can manifest in subtle ways. If you've ever been super frustrated at a situation, say you're looking up information on an order and a chatbot tells you it's delayed. And so you take a couple of really deep regulating breaths before you reply, like, right, complete with the hand motion so that you don't say anything mean. That right there is an emotional connection. Of course, there are some not so subtle ways that we see this too. If you've ever said please or thank you to your phone assistant, you are a very polite person. And also you're emotionally connecting with it. And of course, the prime example that I can personally attest to from my childhood is the Tamagotchi. That's an emotional connection. Our third principle is to keep it simple and clear. I did touch on this a little bit in the previous principle when I mentioned writing unambiguous prompts. And unambiguous is the name of the game here. We're not creating a bot to make our users' lives harder, so let's design like it. The best way I've found to make things really clear is to write down everything you think the user will need to know. Absolutely everything. And then start paring down. Ask yourself, does the user really need to know this piece of information? Or is this a fully automated aspect of the process that they're never going to see or care about? Is this a piece of information that is critical to the user? If it is critical, should it be surfaced sooner? If it's not critical, how crucial is it that it be surfaced right now? So ask your users, ask your teammates, ask your PMs, what does a user need to know right now? And then ask yourself, How can I relay that information in the best way possible? And then as you go through the rest of your design, keep this in mind. Keep asking yourself these questions. Keep doing this sort of shedding of information as you go along. In general, I find that if I start with something that's, say, 3 sentences long, I'll end up with something that's about 1 sentence long by the time we're ready to ship. We also want to give users a way out. Sometimes users get stuck. They're frustrated. Their issue is really complex. They're just not good with technology. Whatever the reason is, they're just not having luck with the bot. And that is okay. We need to be able to help them anyways. So you should always include a safety net for users who need to speak with a real person, whether it's because they've got an issue that the system is automatically escalating, or just because they want to speak to a human being. If your bot isn't set up to connect to a live chat, make sure you have another way of helping users if they need to escalate their issue. And one moment while I get some water, please. And then I did say this in the previous best practice principle about focusing on the user, right? But it is so important that it is its own best practice. It gets another time to shine. Ambiguity has no place in a conversational system. Be clean, be precise, be clear. Do not leave your user confused about what they should do or about what is going on with the system. The fourth best practice principle that we have is to use the right tools. Now, this one is going to depend on what your bot is doing, what modality you're choosing, what channels you're working in, and even who your users are. But there are some goals here that remain constant. You can and should automate where possible. This isn't just going to make your life easier as you scale, but it's also going to make things easier for your users. The more widespread your experience and or UI is, the easier users will find it to adopt. If you've got other systems that users expect your organization to use, then connect your bot to them. So for example, if your organization has data about users' order statuses, you can connect your bot to the system that stores that information so users can query it themselves. The alternative is that your bot has to tell the user that it can't access that information. And if a user really, really wanted to know their order status, that's going to be a major source of frustration for them. You want your bot to be a delight to the user, not a pain point. If users feel like your bot is being obstructionist, and they will, because people ascribe human emotions and actions to bot, they won't use it. And also use the tools and platforms available to you. Your bot will be faster and more accurate if you use the power at your fingertips. And I don't just mean the tools that come with relying on a third-party system for everything. Explore the platform that you're building on to see what capabilities are available to you that you might not know about or might not be using to their fullest extent. So, of course, I work on Power Virtual Agents, so I'm going to take that as my example. Power Virtual Agents has a very flexible authoring canvas that Gary went over yesterday that really lets you break down and flush out topics while you're planning and designing. You can also use it to update your bot while you view your changes in the test bot in the side panel, which lets you sort of fail fast and figure out what direction you need to go in. You can use the native Power Virtual Agents metrics to discover what's going on once your bot launches. And you can also connect to Power BI or other services to get even more insights or more streamlined automation, or to create an ecosystem that works for your organization. The fifth best practice principle, and the one that speaks to the core values of Microsoft itself, is to be inclusive. Make sure that everyone can use your bot. Make sure the needs of all your users are met by the bot. And really importantly, make sure that everyone who uses it feels equally welcomed by the bot. If your bot isn't inclusive, people will feel alienated, not just by the bot, but by your product and by your brand. So don't use language that alienates people, in particular, idiomatic expressions. Make sure you understand that not everyone uses language in the same way that you use language. And that's okay. If you're building a bot in English, for example, you're going to want to make sure that this bot works for American English, British English, Canadian English, Scottish English, Irish English, Australian English, Indian English, and I could keep going, but you get the idea. And each of those is not a singular static entity. Just within American English, there are a lot of regional differences that can completely change the meaning of a word or tone. I'm not going to get into that. That is not what this talk is about. Just know that there are a lot of dimensions across which a language can vary, and country of origin, or more accurately, region, is only one of them. Extant research, your own research, other people on your team, your users, all of these are really good resources at this stage, can be really helpful. You can even get started on your own. A great way to start off is to just read your content aloud to yourself as though you are both the bot and a user. This often helps you understand where your bot might feel sort of too unfriendly or too casual, or where you might have too much information or too little. If the conversation is jarring to you, it's probably going to be jarring to your users. And check your unconscious biases. Make sure that there is a reason behind your choices. Is this a choice you're making because it's adhering to your product or brand strategy? Or is this a choice rooted in something unrelated to the product or organization? We all have unconscious biases. And reminding ourselves to slow down, be aware, that's the best way to make sure that we're being fair and equitable. It is really important to note that there are also ethical considerations here. Microsoft has made a commitment to build better, more trustworthy AI, and bot building is a part of that. Responsible AI is a huge topic, and it could be its own session, and I'm not going to dive into it here today. But I do want to leave you with resources to explore later on. So here are some of the links that you can and should go to on your own. From left to right, a press release from Microsoft's Chief Responsible AI Officer, Natalie Crampton, which also includes a link to Microsoft's Responsible AI Standards. Microsoft's Responsible AI homepage with guidelines, research, and information. And the resources page from the Responsible AI page, where you'll find technology tools, management tools, and guidelines to help you on your journey to building bots more conscientiously. You can access these resources using the shorthand aka.ms links on the screen, aka.ms/MSFTAI framework, aka.ms/responsible CONVAI, and aka.ms/responsible-ai-resources. At its core, inclusive design is about not just making sure everyone has a chair at the table, it's about making sure everyone can participate in the discussion at the table. And best practices and design principles aren't set in stone. We're continually revising what it means to be a best practice. What does that mean in the context of the tools available to makers? And how does that affect the work that we do when we're building tools for makers? And as the cultural narrative around AI continues to develop, how do our best practices hold up in terms of users' contextual understanding of bots? So we evolve and our work evolves as our understanding does. And that ever-moving target is what we're aiming for with these best practice design principles. Thank you so much for attending this session. I believe we now have about 20 minutes for Q&A. And Gary Pretty has joined, I believe, or will be joining. Yes?
Boom.
Gary is here. Hi, Gary. Thank you so much.
Hey.
Gary's a principal product manager with Power Virtual Agents, and he gave an amazing talk on our new authoring canvas yesterday.
That he did. Yeah, and he magically appeared here. And I saw a few questions earlier. Let's see if we can trace them again. Somebody said it was quite interesting about the legal implications of naming your bot. I don't see that question anymore, but as a consideration, we're in California. Let's see, Jen Edith.
California has some very interesting legal implications. If you're very interested, I think you should look up SB 1001, I want to say, off the top of my head, but it is 9 a.m. on a Wednesday, so. But I do believe it is SB 1001. But in California, you are legally required to let people know that they are interacting with a bot, essentially. Bolstering mm-hmm. Online Transparency is the name of the California one. Thank you, Marianne. And what that essentially ends up meaning for the rest of the United States is that you have to let anyone know that you are interacting with a bot, because you can't, and you have to let someone know that they're interacting with a bot if they are located in California. But because you can't tell where someone was located, you can't tell from their VPN because they, you can't tell from their IP address because they could be using a VPN. You have to let everyone know.
I think it's worth saying anyway, and you may have already covered this, but I personally think it's just generally a good idea. It's a good practice to let people
100%.
Know that they're interacting with a bot, because the thing is, I've seen some people who are building bots in the past try and lean in and go, I'm going to make this bot the most realistic thing ever, and I'm going to try and pretend that it's a real person. And all that happens is you end up in this horrific, like, uncanny valley place, and usually it's not even that good. And people just get frustrated, right? They're like, well, if you're a real person, you should be able to understand me. Whereas people are a little bit more forgiving if they know it's a virtual agent.
And I also want to caveat that, I should have caveated this before, I'm not a lawyer, I'm not giving legal advice, okay? I have to say that.
That's very, very good. I think, like, a lot of people are kind of aware, you know, identify now that you are a bot. It's easier for everyone. But I think the general reasoning should be is, like, we're never trying to imitate people. What we're doing is we're using concepts of natural language to make it easier for people to accomplish their goals. And I think a lot of people get that mixed up. It's like, we're playing a game here to just make it easier for you. We're not trying to be human. Whether, you know, you actually explicitly say that in the bot, I think it's like a mindset thing of what you're actually building.
Yep.
Yeah.
What I also like with some of the things that you said, if you know what to look for, what to check for with the best practices, whereas a lot of it, we feel like a lot of it is solved by actually just reading it out loud. Whatever you create, read it out loud. If it sounds bad, it's probably bad, right? And particularly if you do the conversation with someone and you both just read from the script, if the other person loses interest, it's probably too long. If you're not addressing them, they don't care. So there's these very simple checks that I think everybody could do, right? When you create anything, take a few deep breaths, kind of be mindful of the other person before you create anything, to just, you know, be more inclusive from the start and have more empathy there, then have the conversation. And then when you have that draft, just read it out loud. And if it sounds bad, it's probably bad. It's a very simple thing.
There are things that you need to consider with that, of course. Like, are you talking about a bot that is using verbal language versus written language? But in general, I think that's a really good first step. Like, that will weed out the really egregious errors.
Yeah. Let's see. Should a bot be transparent about repair attempts, tracing the origin of misalignments? I'm not fully understanding that question. Maybe you do, or do we need some clarification?
The way I take that is, and I could be wrong, so we could definitely ask for more context, but it sounds like if the bot misunderstands you, or effectively doesn't get something right, should it be open and transparent about saying, hey, I'd like to understand this better next time, where did I go wrong, essentially? And I think it's a fantastic idea. I think in the same way that we can be and should be transparent upfront about the virtual agent, and I saw some comments in the chat about, you know, if a bot has a human name, is that a problem? And I don't think it inherently is. I saw, in fact, today I got an email from my airline saying, hey, I'm the bot and this is my name. But it said, I'm a virtual assistant, I can help you. And so they were very upfront about that. And so I think that people accept that these things aren't perfect. They accept that they're not going to get things right every time. And actually, if they can see that the bot is making a real attempt at getting better and learning for next time, then I think that's an awesome thing. I think there's nothing wrong with that.
I fully agree. I think it's whether or not, like, it depends on what you want from the bot and from the session, like what you want the user to take away that should sort of guide your naming choice. Yeah. A human name is completely acceptable as long as A, you're upfront with the user about the fact that this is a virtual agent. That is an ethical consideration, as well as in some cases a legal one. And if you want to name it something like HR bot, that's also perfectly fine. But if you name a bot an HR bot, people are going to interact with it differently than if you name it Amy.
Yep.
Right? So that is, you have to go into your design knowing that and knowing what capabilities you're bringing to the table with your bot, and knowing what you want your users to assume starting off this conversation should play into that decision. So if you have a very basic bot, HR bot is fine, right?
Yep. Perfect. I mean, I know we've lost our illustrious host who's just suffering from some audio issues, but I see another question here, which I think would be great for you to pick up, which is, firstly, really informative session. Thank you. So that's awesome feedback. It says, we've integrated with several internal applications, but always repeat all the information back to the customer for confirmation before creating the IT ticket or property job, etc. Would that be something that you recommend against? Or is it more specific to the scenario?
I think honestly, without knowing more information, of course, that to me is something that sounds like it's specific to the scenario, because you do want the user to know this is what I'm putting in for you, right? And so that is, that actually sort of meets the sort of minimalism criteria, because that is the sort of minimal amount of information that you want the user to know before you proceed, right? You could proceed with saying, okay, I put everything in, but it, the question really is at that point, do you want the user to double check what they've put in or not? If you feel that your users are regularly going through and saying like, yes, that's all good. Yes, that's all good. Yes, that's all good. Maybe what you can do instead is say, would you like to double check, right? And give them that option, right?
I think it also depends on whether or not you change the, if you have control over the way that the information is displayed. So for example, within Power Virtual Agents, we would maybe ask several sequential questions, gathering some information, and maybe we can present that information back as a card, right? Which is just a summary card that says, hey, does this information look right? Well, I don't think we would necessarily suggest that you read everything out in individual sequential messages and like 100%. Fill up the conversation. So I think you have to really think carefully about how you're displaying that information as well.
Yep. Yeah. You really have to consider what it is that they're seeing and how it is that they're going to view that. Is that going to be an annoyance to them, essentially?
Right. Exactly.
Yeah.
Hey, he's back. Hopefully the audio problems are resolved.
I can hear you.
Was it your dad jokes that got you kicked off?
We can hear you now. Yeah.
I thought it was the battery, but I'm not sure. I can hear myself 5 times now.
So we had some great conversation while you were away, so it was all good.
Good.
Yeah. Jen said customers and people instead of users, I think it sounds like, which are also great names. I tend to stay away from people instead of users just because that is too broad. I'll read one message above. This is a half-form question. I wonder how we might work towards not just validating problems, but affirming people. Oh, yeah. So using their names or pronouns. Oh, that is an excellent, excellent point. And I love that it works towards being more inclusive of the users. And I think that that is a question that is sort of based on which, like where you are in your bot. Are you reflecting back the name that they've given you? Or are you pulling data from a database that they, like, you know, have they logged in and so you're pulling data from somewhere else? Are you using pronouns in your bot? I did once work on a conversational system where we had to avoid using pronouns entirely because we went multilingual and English was okay to do that, but then we went into languages that had gender verbs and oh boy, that was fun. but we had to figure out a way to create prompts that did not sort of use the gender of the interlocutor, of the person who was speaking to the bot. So that, because at that point with that bot that we were using, the interlocutor had not given the bot their preferred gender or their preferred name. That was not something that we were comfortable asking for and that our legal counsel at the time had said, no, you cannot do this, right? Mm-hmm. So it is going to be, I think, heavily dependent on what your bot is doing, but you also want to be really aware of it and make sure that you're not just saying, oh, well, then because I can't ask for this, I'm just going to default to something, right? So do what you can, get as far as you can, be inclusive, and then when you can't do something, make sure that you're not just defaulting to something because you can't do more, right? If you can't ask for pronouns, don't use pronouns, right? But don't do it in a way that makes it awkward. Right. It is possible. Yeah. It's a huge ask. Right. It took us, I want to say 2 months to do this. But we got to the point where we did 5 languages worth of prompts without gendered words. So it's possible.
It reminds me of a book written by Georges Perec, who's a French Jewish author, and he wrote a book without the letter E in it.
French?
Yeah, and it was about the Holocaust. So he wanted to talk about removing people from society. So he wrote a book without the letter E, and then I think it took a Dutch team 26 years to translate that book.
I am so impressed. Did the Dutch team also remove the letter E, or did they remove a different letter?
Well, it's the same. It's the same challenge. I think he after that book, he wrote a story in which the only or not the only letter, but the only what kind of letter is it? So he only used E instead of the A and the I. What's that called in English? Those letters?
A vowel.
Yeah, a vowel. Yeah. So then the only exactly. Thank you, everybody. So then he would only use the E. Yeah. That was a short story, though.
That is an accomplishment. Wow.
I just wanted to pick up on one note that was in the chat just now, which is I'll read it out. It's, I hate the IT support bot in my company. I have to deal with it, and I cannot make my ticket. So first, I describe the issue in my bot. Then when I'm connected to the human, I need to write the issue again in the window. Then when the human connects, they ask me how I can help. So I'm furious and I've got to type it for the third time. And then I get in touch with the human and they still don't know what's happening. So it takes more than 10 minutes and it's incredibly frustrating. And then someone else was like, yeah, this is way too common. And I have to agree. I think like all of us, I go through this all the time. Sadly, I don't think this is just a conversational AI issue. I think what this is really just poor contact center design, right? It's poor contact center design. The number one useful thing that you can have in this situation, certainly if you're designing this, where you're handing between bots and humans or even multiple bots, is context. Context is king. And the more context that you can gather, the better, right? I mean, certainly when we are within Power Virtual Agents, we have integration with Dynamics Omnichannel Customer Service, right, to enable sort of end-to-end contact center scenarios. And we've thought heavily about how can we make sure that we're passing over context so that exactly this situation doesn't happen. And the same goes for when you're handing off between one bot and another and the ability to hand off context. And so I think really it's just a great point. I just thought it was useful to make sure that we're thinking about, because so often we see people who are designing, they design their bot in isolation. And then they go, right, I'm now going to plug this into my contact center and I'm going to hand off to a human agent. And there's no real thought over that contract. And it's not real. If we should really think about how would it work if it was a human handing off to a human? They wouldn't go, hey, I've got someone to speak to you and put the phone down. They would say, hey, I've got a customer here that I've been speaking to and here's what they've told me so far. Here's their problem. Can you help them? Yeah, absolutely. Sure. Even this goes right down to bot design as well. We're enabling within PBA the ability for you to persist variables across sessions for users. So if we can identify that it's the same, we can't identify the user, but if we can identify that it's the same caller, for example. So if I call the bot on multiple days from the same phone number, and the bot will be able to, within the appropriate compliance, remember certain contextual information about me. And so, so we can enable those more engaging experiences like, hey, Gary, thanks for calling back. And so I think context is huge. And it's something that we've really only scratched the surface of within conversational AI. It's a hard thing to do, but it's a super important thing to think about when you're designing your conversation.
Yeah, what do you see a lot? Because sometimes if you want to do that big perfect thing, then so much is involved. And but you see projects sometimes when they want to do that on day one, then it never gets off the ground. So it seems you want to start in that simple way on a little island, just start testing it out. But then there's this moment
start and scale
that nobody can identify where it's like, okay, now let's bring in more people and think about it in a more strategic way. It's difficult to find that threshold of when to bring in all the suits and slow down the project to actually make it better than long term.
I do want to point out that, and I ran into this issue. I think Megan and Marianne both brought this up, I think. Just Megan, sorry, running through the comments. This is like going to the doctor and when you have to, you know, fill out the form and then tell the nurse and then the doctor asks you all the same questions, right? It's common everywhere, right? But like if you create a situation where you can persist that information throughout, it's useless unless you can get the people on the other end to read it, right? So you can't just consider like what is the end-to-end bot situation. Like, you know, it doesn't end when you get that information out to the other person. You also have to consider what is that experience when I'm getting it out, right? And so it may not be your team who's working on this. I worked in the medical field medical UX field for 4 years. And this was something we ran into time and again. You know, we'd send off the information and then we'd hear back from users that they were frustrated with the bots because the bots weren't doing their job. And at the end of the day, it wasn't the bots, right? It's the people who aren't reading the information the bot is sending off. So we have to sort of make it, we have to incentivize the people at the other end to read that, whether that is making it super easy for them, whether that is making sure that they, you know, whatever it is that works for your organization, it needs to function fully end to end, like human to human, not just bot front to bot end, right? Like this is not, it doesn't end when the bot ends. So that is just a consideration that really all too often gets put to the wayside.
Yeah. And on that note, I'm afraid that this is all that we have time for, but I really like the ending because we actually had a conversation about that this morning. It's like, should that be a whole, how do we create a course around, you know, making it part of the entire journey, whether it's a patient journey or a customer journey. Thank you so much, everybody, for being here, and you both, Esther and Gary. Sorry that my audio dropped. We've had more people experience that today, so not sure what's going on here. So the good news is this is not the end. So we have more sessions. So everybody, like we've done before, if we leave this room and then we reconvene in the other one, I know a few people are already there. And then I believe we're going to hear from Voiceflow. They're going to talk about, you know, collaboration and enterprises around conversation design, which should also be fun. So thank you so much to the two of you. And it was very good, very, very insightful. And
well, thank you. Thank you for having us.
Thank you so much.
And thanks to everybody in the audience. Thank you.